This episode of The Get Down is brought to you by Digital Music Pool. Digital Music Pool is the ultimate record pool for professional DJs looking for the hottest tracks and exclusive hits updated daily in an easy-to-use platform. You can find exclusive edits from myself, Angelo the Kid, Dramos, Castra, and Pat C only on DMP. And we're giving you a chance to try their service for free for 21 days. All you have to do, go to digitalmusicpool.com, create an account, and enter the promo code THEGETDOWN at checkout for your free 21 days. DMP is my go-to site when downloading new music, so check out their site free for 21 days with the code THEGETDOWN. You will not be disappointed. What's up, guys? If you enjoy The Get Down, we would greatly appreciate if you would rate and review our podcast. The more positive reviews we receive, the more DJs that can listen and benefit from the show. Also, we will be sending out Get Down DJs t-shirts to random people who review us. So get those reviews in and make them count. This episode, we have DJ producer SoWavveyy, along with his friend and manager and longtime New Jersey promoter, Mark G, on the show. Like Gary and I with our businesses, Wavveyy and Mark are a great example of two like-minded people coming together to help each other grow exponentially faster than if they stayed out on their own. Wavveyy's been one of the fastest growing DJs coming out of the pandemic and has extended his brand outside of New Jersey into other markets like Philadelphia and even blessing the stage of Firefly Festival in Delaware. After earning his stripes in the NJ club scene as a promoter working at New Jersey's top venues, Mark G has now branched off to start throwing his own parties, partnering with various DJs and venues, and booking countless artists and DJs over the last 6 months. On this episode, we talk about various topics like helping each other out during quarantine, the impact of social media on the current state of DJ bookings, as well as the importance of consistent and effective networking. We cover a lot this episode, so let's get into the 53rd episode of The Get Down with SoWavveyy and Mark G. All right, what's up, guys? Welcome to the 53rd episode of The Get Down. My name is Cream.
Gary W here.
We have some guests this episode. We have DJ producer, DJ SoWavveyy. What up, brother?
What up, what up? It's a pleasure to be here.
And generally, wherever Wavveyy is, Mark G's probably sure to follow. So we had to say what's up to my boy, Mark Geiger, Mark G. Party with Mike, Mark G. You might know him as well. What's up, man?
What's going on, guys? Thank you for having us.
Yeah, this is going to be good because we like chop it up and have really great conversations about the industry and music, like via text or phone call or when we hang out. So like, this is going to be an extension of one of those, I feel like.
Cream, me, you, and Mark's group text is probably one of the more entertaining texts that I'm on because Mark likes to bring a little bit of like chippiness to the conversation. So it's always fun.
Yeah, he likes to stir the pot a little bit.
Yeah, and then when I'm wrong, I just leave and you won't hear from me for another 3 months.
Right. Yeah, like something we're not going to bring up on the podcast, something recent.
We're not going to bust your balls too bad today.
No, it's okay. Dipset took a huge L and that's all I'll say.
All right, so one of the reasons why I really wanted to have you guys on is because you guys are kind of a rare breed in the fact that it's a DJ and a promoter that you guys really like teamed up. You're really close friends and you have a really great working relationship. And Mark, you kind of almost act as Wavveyy's manager in a lot of situations. And you guys have really grown greatly since you've really teamed up and really pushed like the two of you guys working together. So talk to me a little bit about why you did that and how it's helped.
Mark, I'm gonna let you kick that off and tell your side of the story first because he likes to lie.
a short version, and the only real version is Ezra actually grew up with my little sister, and when I first found out he was DJing everything, he was DJing actually at a local bar, but he was underage, so I couldn't really get him into any of the spots. And one of the times I ran into him, whatever, he was one of these days I'm gonna work with you, And at the time I was running around with DJ Wawa. I was doing his bookings and managing him like at a certain, just like, you know, a handful of venues or whatever. And I was like, yeah, whatever, Ezra, whatever, Ezra. Already turned 21. A few months prior to him turning 21, I called him and asked him if he wanted the DJ's 21st at Harris. And he pretty much told me to go fuck myself because he's going to Miami. So I was like, all right, now you got to wait a whole year. So then I booked him on his 22nd birthday to DJ at Harris. I wasn't there for it. But I was getting phone calls throughout the whole night. So then I kept an eye on him. And then, I mean, it was just pretty much, it was like, gonna happen regardless. And he asked me one day, he was like, yo, he's like, you want to be my manager? And I was like, it's not just like, oh, hey, you want to be my manager? There's like stuff that we have to sit down and talk about. And obviously, I mean, here we are 4 years later, we worked everything out and everything has been great since, from what you guys see. We're literally like almost inseparable, even when we're not in the nightclubs. Like I said, we're sitting next to each other right now. We had dinner together.
Well, you can literally see Mark in the back of Ezra's screen right there.
Yeah. It's just, you know, everything that we do, even me, you said, you know, as a promoter and everything, 9 out of 10 times, SoWavveyy's like low key a silent partner on it, or always has input and advice on most of the stuff I'm doing. I'm like, yo, like, do you think this is the right move? Or this is the right move. And I mean, he may be only 25, but he's got the mind of a 50-year-old.
I got a question.
So he's usually looking out for his best interest for me 9 out of 10 times.
You said something interesting there, because as somebody who as you know, we book DJs as well, obviously, and there's that importance of being available for that initial booking. So it's like, because you said like, oh, you asked him to do it. He was out in Miami. And it was like, all right, well, now I'm going to make this guy wait around for a year and then I'll let him, you know, get on board. I always find that to be, you know, of the utmost importance. If you're looking to break into a group or you're looking to break into a certain venue and somebody asks you to play there, like, you should probably make that first priority. I don't care what you have going on. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I think in... I mean, he'll probably correct me when I say this, but in that situation, he didn't even really know how good of a DJ he was at the time and where his career was going to go. So I think him waiting the full year and seeing what I was capable of doing, what I was doing at all these different clubs and venues, actually helped our process easier, because he saw that I already had access to most of the big nightclubs in Jersey. You know, I was doing a couple of things here and there in New York. And I think that helped us, you know, helped with the trust level of me taking over literally 95 to 100% of his bookings.
I think as like Wavveyy, having like that base of being out there and like struggling, not even struggling, but just like going through the motions of building your brand and getting more bookings and introducing yourself and getting your name out there. Like while you guys were kind of talking and working a little bit, you were out there like earning your stripes, so to speak, right?
Yeah, 100%. So I guess I'll tell my side of the story now, since Mark gave you the fairy tale version of it. So only I would say probably about 33% of that story was true. Mark and I know each other because his sister and I grew up with each other. We grew up in the same town. So I grew up, you know, seeing Mark everywhere and he saw me everywhere. And I was just one little annoying kid to him that he would, you know, Mark had his license and I still on scooters and falling off of bikes. And he would come scoop me up here and there and I would burn CDs every once in a while. He would just ask, he'd be like, yo, whatever's hot, burn a CD for. So like, this is before I was even a DJ. Like I didn't really start DJ, I went off to college.
I think we're just lagging a little bit. Let's say we got a little technical difficulty. All right, I'm gonna pause the recording real quick. We might have lost somebody.
Yeah, it's all good.
We're gonna pause for 2 seconds. We'll be right back. All right, so we're back. Ez, if you want to just continue, where you kind of left off.
Like I was saying, so Mark would come pick me up here and there, drive me places when it was cold, whatever the fact may be. And he would like always tell me to burn him a CD of whatever was hot so he could just play in the car, which this dates back to, of course, I'm burning CDs. So you could imagine how old I was, probably 14 years old. I don't know how old I was. So I burned him CDs or whatever. And then I wasn't even DJing at the time. Like, I really did not become a DJ until I would say I went to college. Like, I would make mixes here and there, like just on my computer on like virtual DJ, and I would put them on SoundCloud and people would play them. But like, that's about it. Like, I wasn't doing any parties. Wasn't really branding myself as a DJ. I was just like making mixes. And then Mark was already in the scene. He was just like, yeah, we're going to work together one day. I never said, Mark, we're going to work together one day. I'm going to be a DJ and I'm going to work for you one day. So fast forward, I go to college and my roommates threw me into the scene. Like, there was a big DJ. I went to Ryder. There was a big DJ on campus. He did all the parties. And he was like, I don't know. We were like the cooler, like freshmen that came in. So like, we were going to invite to all the parties, blah, blah. And he was like, I guess he was speaking on like how, you know, he wants to pass the throne to somebody. My friends just threw me to the wolves. They're like, oh, he's a DJ. I'm like, bro, I don't have a mixer. I don't have anything. I'm like, what do you think? Why would you do that?
Yeah.
So I got gifted. My dad gifted me some stuff. Like I had like a Numark Mix Track Pro 2 or something, like little like Numark. I had some like ghetto speakers, whatever. And I just made it work. Like, I would just do parties here and there on campus. And then next thing you know, I'm doing all the frats, doing all the sororities. And then I end up opening for Travis Scott. And that was like one of my biggest gigs. And I was not like just started. So you can imagine how the nerves were for that. And, you know, Travis Scott, right when his burgeoning traps dropped. So like, that's when his career like went like that. Whatever. Fast forward, I turned 21, and at the time, like, I'm DJing, I love it, but I'm just like, you know, it was just a side thing. I'm in school, I'm working, I'm like, whatever, like, if DJing comes, it comes. So Mark's like, yo, I want to book you in AC for your 21st. You said back in the day, I told you we were going to work together someday, and I'm like, nah, I'm going to Miami, bro, I'll catch you next time. So Mark's like, all right. He's like, I'll talk to you in a year from now. I guess he completely just blew me off for like a whole year. Once that part was true, he definitely did blow me off. And like at that time, I would, like you said, I would play at the local bar. Like I had my hands already in different places. Like I had, you know, my clientele was really a whole bunch of Ryder students. So I had a clientele that Mark was like, all right, this guy has a following already. This is smart. And then on top of that, I was doing local spots. So like I was already DJing at that local spot, like from, you know, when I first started from 18 all the way up to, I still book DJs there at the spot. And every time I would do it, I would pack it out. So Mark was definitely watching me the whole time. And he knew what he was doing. Fast forward to when I'm 22 years old, he's like, hits me up. He's like, yo, let's try this again. He's like, I'm gonna book you at Harris for your 22nd birthday. I'm like, all right, let's do it this time. I guess I'll skip the Miami part. I go out there, and I'm playing on the rooftop at the time too. I'm not even inside. Like, he got me the little rooftop thing, and like the rooftop was packed. And I could tell, like, the guy at the time that was working there was looking at me, and he's like, "Yo, what did you do?" Like, I want people inside. Why is there so many people outside? I'm like, I posted it, and a whole bunch of people came. So then from that day forward, Mark's like, yo, they're hitting me up all night. We need to work more often. I'm like, how about we do this? You handle my bookings and we'll take it from there. And then it's been game ever since.
Man, it's a relationship that really seems to work out nicely. You know what I mean? You guys seem to really have a good relationship. You know, obviously you're getting along, and sometimes it's really hard to balance the friend work relationships, as Kareem and I can probably attest to. You know, you do have some tough moments where you're going to disagree, but, you know, it's just, if it's going to work, it's going to work, you know, in the long run.
Yeah, 100%. Right. You know what it is? Like you said, the biggest, I think a lot of people say don't mix work with pleasure type of situation, but you know what it is that we're friends first at the end of the day. And we just want the best interests for each other. And I think with that, no matter in what group or partnership you have, you want someone that's always going to put you in place, because you're not always going to be right. And I'm definitely that person for him. Like, I'm always, even as a young, even when I was young, like, I would tell 100%. Him, I would tell him how it is. Like, nah, like, I'm not going. I'm going to Miami. Like, I think he saw that from, like, a young age where I'm like, I don't care that you told me I'm going to go play at Harris. Like, I'm going to Miami this time, and I'll catch you next time.
It's so important, though, to have somebody to bounce, like, feedback off of. And, hey, like, what do you think about this opportunity? What do you think about this number? What do you think about working with this person? Yeah. Like, if you're just out there on your own, it's hard to make those decisions sometimes. So it's good to have somebody that isn't in your shoes that can kind of give their outside perspective that sometimes we need as DJs, right? 100%. Like, so, I mean, that's one way that Gary and I have really relied on each other over the years. And then, I mean, among other things, but I think the other thing for you guys, which is a huge benefit, is like, Mark can be the bad guy in a lot of situations, you know? And that doesn't affect you.
You mean Mark is the bad guy?
you literally hit
the
nail.
That's your job, Mark.
You hit the nail, bro. Like, I know. He has to be the voice for many reasons, and I'm super grateful for that.
Yeah, like Mark, you need that person that can hard negotiate or tell somebody they fucked up on the flyer or that the party's not getting pushed enough. As the DJ, it's really hard for us to be able to do that. Yeah. Because you never want to burn a bridge. You don't want to not get booked again. So, like when venues or promoters are dealing with a manager, they expect that from the DJ. They're like, "Why the fuck is this DJ talking to me like that?" Exactly. Kind of thing. A lot of times.
Exactly.
So yeah, it's a huge advantage.
We're coming at
something else.
We're coming at this. Coming at this from the talent perspective. I think that you're looking at things, Mark, from a business perspective. So like, you know, there are little things that you're picking out that us three probably aren't picking up initially.
Yeah.
You know,
one thing that I will say, I mean, since almost pretty much like when I really got up and running in the industry, I've always rolled with at least one consistent DJ, whether it was a weekly event or a monthly event, or I was handling shit for them. One thing that's really worked out well for me in SoWavveyy is that I've had the experience of always constantly dealing with just, you know, with one person, like, hey, let me do this. Or I've encountered something like this in the past. This is the way we should play it out. Or this is what we shouldn't do. And so on and so on. And I mean, that's what I think helps us in the long run, because it's the experience thing. And the people's eye, SoWavveyy could literally do no wrong because I'm the asshole. He's the good guy.
It's such an important thing in this industry is to be able to live through mistakes and live through realistically in any industry, in any business, you know, more experience you have, just like you said, and the more failures you take, you know, the more, positives that you can build on going forward and then you can coach up your younger guys just as, you know, you're coaching up Wavveyy.
Yeah. And I mean, Ezra will vouch for me on this, I hope, because I know I said it to him. One of the first things I ever said to him when we really like got serious about it, me being his manager and we were starting to break into the bigger clubs and everything, I said, if you ever have a problem with a manager, an owner, a promoter, or a booker, I said, shake their hand, smile on their face, then tell me and I'll deal with it. I said, that's the easiest way we're going to go about it. And as you can see, 4 years later, everyone hates me.
I think Murray had the asshole. I think he gave himself the asshole title way before I came into the picture. So I think that it just worked out perfectly.
I don't know about that.
It's so important, though, as the talent, not to step on toes, because that's going to cause you not to get booked again, right? So you let your manager. That's why you have a manager, to deal with all the bullshit,
yeah, right? 100%.
And then it.
Now let me ask you guys a quick question. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, you're good. Go ahead.
When you guys are dealing with DJs that have managers, is it easier for you guys, or is it like, damn, I want to book this guy, but he's got a manager and I really don't want to talk to the manager? I've never got to talk to somebody but you guys are both.
Kareem, go ahead on that.
Yeah, I mean, we honestly have kind of focused more on cultivating our own talent rather than going to guys that are already established in the industry for a number of reasons. So I don't know. We haven't, have we booked anybody that had a manager? I'm not even sure, to be honest.
We deal with one of my really good friends growing up, his DJ group. Radar. I've known Ron since I'm 7 years old. So it's different because like I can go to him about stuff that like his DJs are doing and vice versa. So that's a different situation, I guess. But they're really the only ones where we have like serious crossover where there is management in place. But we do go directly to each other if we're using one another's talent and if there's an issue or, you know, anything really, you know, whether it be flyers or an issue with being late, whatever it might be, we'll just directly go to each other. And that's how we deal with it. Right. It's just the best way to do it instead of like, I'm not going to go at the DJ, right? I'm going to go at the manager, you know, and I'll deal with it accordingly with him. And then we can work it out. Whereas like, oh, I'm not going to book him again. And he's like, well, this has never happened in the past. This isn't like him. Okay. Then I'll probably, you know, think about giving a second chance, you know, and talk to Cream about it, things along those lines. And that's why you do talk to the manager. Cause like, you know, you're going to get a straight answer. You're going to get like a little history on the guy and then I can go back to Cream about it and talk about it that way.
I think one way too, that we kind of delve into that world is dealing with managers at the venues, because our DJs are in there and we're kind of the liaison between the venue and our DJs. So our DJs are giving us feedback on what's going on at the venue, how they were treated, you know, like if they had to pay for drinks or anything that like we would then have to go deal with the manager, and vice versa. The manager would then tell us, hey, this guy crushed it. We really liked his energy. We liked the music he played. He brought a lot of people. And then we could relay that to the DJ. In the same vein, if it's bad or negative feedback, it's really important that we then go to the artist and say, hey, like we obviously have to come up with a way to constructively criticize them and help them get better for the next time that they're there. So we're not necessarily dealing with artist managers, but we're kind of managing DJs and also being the liaison between a venue and a DJ or an artist. So.
Yeah, 100%. You guys are doing a good job at that, especially now that the world opened back up. You guys are making sure that all you guys are staying booked, which is a very big thing.
Yeah, I mean, we've been lucky. I think all four of us in this room set ourselves up heavy over the time we were off. And that there's a reason why we're all doing pretty good right now, because we didn't crawl under a rock for a year. Like we did as much as we possibly could.
Well, let's talk about
go ahead. What's up? Go ahead. No, I keep cutting you off.
I was gonna say, let's talk about that. Like why, like how did we all stay relevant, right? Like social media was a driving force in all four of us. And our company's staying relevant throughout quarantine, right?
Almighty Instagram Live.
Well, right, that. And then Twitch became a thing later on. And just like really just being involved in all social media platforms, I think gave us all the upper hand when quarantine came to an end. You guys want to talk a little bit about, you know, what your plan was? Was there a plan going into your social media during quarantine and how you executed?
As you want to go first?
I guess so. The way I look at it, and Mark vouched for me as well from our conversations behind that, especially during quarantine when places were closed and we wanted to make sure that our names didn't exit people's brains, is that you're nowadays your social media is your resume, I feel like, which sucks, but it is. So Mark is very big on as content, no matter, like a big motto of ours is all content is good content, no matter what it is. So kind of sort of depends, but you know what I mean? Most content is good content. So that's kind of how we wanted to stay relevant, especially during quarantine, you know, Instagram lives, different. I let Mark touch on upon some of the things that he wanted to put together. But for my sake, I wanted to make sure I just kept my audience engaged, let them know that, okay, I'm stuck inside too. You're stuck inside. How can we help each other? How can I entertain you? Like how I would entertain you in the club, things of that nature. So Mark, and do you have anything on that?
I mean, yeah, pretty much was the same thing, you know, except I always kept, you know, in contact with the people that, you know, were mostly I was working for at the time. And also that were, you know, our favorite places to play, and the guys that always made sure that we were booked, I would always reach out. And then, you know, the reason why we're in the position we are now, once quarantine opened up, everyone was like kind of scared to go back to the clubs and work and everything. And I said, no, I jumped right on it. And from there, I mean, the booking started coming in for SoWavveyy, and people were like, oh, you know, we can only do opera at 25-50%. And I said, that's fine. Just don't forget about us, you know, when everything opens back up. And I mean, I'm not afraid to say that there were gigs that he did for low to where I didn't even get paid on, which is fine because look at where we are now. It's August 10th and we got a whole September, a whole August and September already locked in. I'm working on October right now, you know? And then from there, from me being outside in the midst of, you know, last summer, opened my eyes, and Ezra was, you know, a big factor on this, that I didn't need to essentially work under anybody. Not that it was a bad thing that I was working under anybody, but it opened my eyes to start throwing my own events. And luckily I teamed up with DJ Focus. You remember him from the DJ battle, Gary?
Yeah.
DJ Focus actually gave me a couple opportunities to where we were doing, you know, we were doing legal, legit parties together. And then from there, I, you know, someone was like, damn, he was like, yeah, you're really rocking during the quarantine. Why don't you come over here and do this with me? And that's how we got linked up with Frankie at Lobby. And I mean, knock on wood, everything's been good since.
Yeah, I think, well, you guys, you started the DJ battles on live, which we were all involved in, which were super fun. Nothing else was going on. And we were just like literally pulling genres out of a hat and then having to go like song for song.
the biggest thing with that, I think that was just DJ.
Yeah, there it is.
He still has all the genres. I think when once you come into this nightlife space as DJ space, you kind of gain some type of brotherhood, no matter how much you speak to one another. You know what I mean? I think that was just uplifting each other's spirits. You know, for a lot of DJs, this is your life. This is your livelihood. And when you lose that, you lose a whole part of you. So I feel like, you know, quarantine could, you know, people fell into depression and things of that nature. So like just having those DJ battles, just to hop on live or something, or a Zoom or something like this, just gave people something to look forward to, even just DJ, even if it's just amongst each other, you know what I'm saying? And something that I really, really envy Mark about, that he's good at it, I'm not. He's always going to check on people, always going to make sure someone's good, whoever he works with. Like, I mean, that's something that I lack. And I think that's why we work so well with each other, because there's things that he lacks in that I have, and there's things that he lack, that he lacks in that I have. Did I just say that? Whatever. You know what I mean? And vice versa. Yeah, exactly. Vice versa. So no, he's really, really, really good at that. And I think that what really set up a lot of this success that we see today and all the things that are going forward, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, you were able to showcase what you could do as a DJ and meet other DJs and grow stronger relationships with DJs who matter in this tri-state area. And Mark, at the same time, you were able to listen to other DJs play who maybe you didn't know, who you might have found that you could work with. Also, you know, keep your name out there. Like Frankie, who you have a party with, won one of the battles, right?
Yeah, Frankie, I think, won the first one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I had my broken elbow, so I was like judging a lot of that one. He won the first one, and like now you guys have a party together. So like being active and creating these relationships and just doing something for the community and the culture was something that helped both you guys so much. But I want to transition a little over into the social media world, right? So obviously social media was always really important. The quarantine, it was super important. And now after quarantine, do you guys feel like that the social media aspect is too relied upon with DJs getting booked? I have like 8 questions here. So that's the first question. What do you think about that?
So what's the actual question?
Do you think that that bookers and promoters and other DJs rely too heavily on using social media in order to actually like book a DJ.
So for example,
rather than like skills or the OG way of like coming up through
right.
the ranks.
The reason I brought this up to Cream is because we had an issue with this, let's say a couple of weeks ago, right? And I feel like the person that was booking was looking at followers instead of looking at actual talent. And it,
yeah.
and I might rant a little bit here. It fucking infuriates me. I hate it. Like, you know what? You're and Mark, listen, and there's no disrespect to what you guys.
Oh, no. Because what you guys do. My answer is going to be completely, you're going to be completely for my answer.
But it's like, but do your fucking homework. You know what? I can't just look at followers and understand what you do as a DJ in a room. Just because you have 22,000 followers doesn't mean you're a good DJ. It might just mean you go to a big university and you DJed one party and you got a bunch of followers because you opened up for Loud Luxury or whatever it might be. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I think Xing somebody out because they don't have a lot of followers, and I'm probably speaking because I don't have a lot of followers. So that's part of this. But Xing somebody out because they don't have a lot of followers, like, I don't think that's an effective way of booking. You should really do your homework and make sure that the DJ is capable of doing the party that you're booking them for. Go ahead.
So funny that you say that. First time I ever booked Cream, what was the first time I ever booked you? Did I meet you or hear you yet?
No.
first time I ever booked Cream with the strength of someone else in the industry's word. First three times I booked Cream, I've had phone conferences with him, phone calls with him, I mean, and I'd never heard him. I did my homework and I listened to one of his mixes or whatever, but that was about it. I didn't meet Cream till maybe 5-6 months into me booking him. The way that I look, I don't look at people's Instagrams and how many followers they have and whatever. Like I said off air before, I get so many DMs a day and everyone just cares about bringing people out. Yeah, that as a DJ, that's cool and all. I book based on preference of skill. If I have a personal relationship with you, if I know you're a good DJ, you're not going to be, am I allowed to curse?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're not going to be a dickhead in the club. You're going to be respectful to the point where that the owner is going to want you to come back. Now, on the other end of it, if I have you booked for, say, next Saturday, right? And it's Tuesday, the week before. If I get the flyer, I want you to put it up. You know, hey, look, guys, next Saturday, I'll be there, blah, blah, blah. That's it. Your job's done. The week of, I expect you to put it up once a day. Because, and I tell a lot of Cream's guys this, your guys this, you don't know how big your following is or who actually bases their weekends going out to see the Gary W's or the SoWavveyy's or the DJ Creams. You know, there's people out there that you guys don't even know that probably attend 75 to 80% of your gigs that you guys don't even know about, but they know where to see you because of your social media. That's why I think you're not promoting my party in a sense. You're also promoting yourself. So when you want to post the flyer the night before or the day of, and that's it. One, the owners are always watching. Two, the promoters are always watching. Three, you're discrediting yourself and your brand. That's how I feel on it. So I don't necessarily think that the followers are a big thing, but the way that I do my bookings is it's more friendships and talent than it is anything else.
I think that's a huge credit to your success, right? You're running a good ship over there. Like, looking at followers versus, you know, word of mouth in the industry is completely different. Like, Cream and I always book on word of mouth. Like, hey, do you know this guy? Have you ever heard him? Do you think he'll do well in this space? Right. Specifically, it's always within whatever space that we're booking for. I think that's two different things, right? Like, but there are plenty of people, right, Mark, that look at somebody's followers and are like, all right, fine, I'm going to book him because he could probably book like 6 or 7 tables. And I don't feel like that's the right way to go about it.
There are people that do that, but those are the guys that aren't really successful, because you got to remember, Yeah, Instagram deleted a shit ton of the fake accounts and everything, but you could still buy those followers back and have 250,000 people. But here's my thing with the whole social media. It's cool to make the Instagram videos and the TikTok videos and everything. But I even over quarantine, I was telling everybody, don't fall into it and make that your number one source and your number one, way of getting bookings, because you could have people, you could have 10,000 people on TikTok following you from Indonesia.
Right.
But it's time, when you go to a booker or a promoter, I got 30,000 followers, Instagram, 10, like I said, 10,000 of them can be from Indonesia. Are those 10,000 showing up to a club in New Jersey?
Right.
You look at it in an aspect like that, where it's like, oh, I got 30,000 followers. Okay, that's cool. But what is that going to do for my venue? You know what I mean? So those people that were looking at it like that pre-quarantine and pre-COVID, I think stop that. And they're going back to the, let me go with what I know works best. And also, I like the trend of seeing a lot of the younger upcoming DJs are getting a lot more work now. Which, by the way, Cream will vouch for me. I did say it was going to happen.
Yeah, because they were the ones who were able to accept any booking that came their way, because they didn't care. Opportunity was more important than the dollar amount for those guys and girls.
Right. When we came
in many cases,
when we came out of quarantine, right, the number was lower everywhere. So they were more willing to accept that number for a longer period of hours, let's call it. And I think they were able to showcase their talent and they thrive. We talk about that all the time on this show. Yeah.
There's just less DJs too, as far as like some of the older guys kind of phased out and used the quarantine time to be like, all right, well, I'm kind of towards the end of my career anyway. I'm going to move to something else. So, Wavveyy, what do you think as far as using Instagram for bookings for you? And like, was it a successful, like, were you successful at it in the past? And is that something you?
Yeah, I think it's a double-edged sword for me. Like, I think it's, like I said, I think your social media is your resume in this case, because we're in a time now where a lot of things are virtual. You know what I'm saying? So it's, what I think is that the bottom line is times have changed. Everything that you guys have said have been correct, but there's also part of it where times have changed. It's not a time anymore where people go to the place and they know what they're going to get. Like, I'm going to the tunnel tonight because I know I'm going to have a good time and it's going to be packed. Like, I think now that we're in a time where places are so bottle driven and who can spend the most money, that clubs legit have stopped caring about their atmosphere completely. Like, for me, I think that when I think of places where I want to go, I go strictly off the atmosphere and hospitality, you know what I'm saying? I think, and all that stuff are starting to fade away. Places are so bottle driven and who spends the most money that they don't care about the hospitality and atmosphere. So it's like, okay, I want to book this DJ. He sucks, but I know he's going to get me 12 tables and they're going to spend $10,000 each table They don't care about anything else. They're like, okay, I'm just looking at the green. And I think we're coming to a time where that's so driven now that's why social media is so important. So they're looking like, okay, this guy over here has 100,000 followers. I'm going to book him because it looks cool for my place. And he has to be somebody important because he has that many followers, but we know it's most of the time that's not even the case.
Yeah.
So I think that's what a big thing, a big driving force on that of why things are the way they are. But I see both sides, you know what I'm saying? So like, going back to what I was saying before, that social media is your resume. I think it's important to have a social media presence, but you can't just use that. And because it's going to bite you, eventually people are going to stop booking you. And we saw that there was a lot of great, bigger DJs not getting booked during quarantine because their number is too high or their pride's too high. Oh, I'm not playing there. Or, it's not really worth it. Or, you know what I'm saying? So these other guys who probably have just as much talent, but they only have 200 followers, they were getting these opportunities. And they were bringing people, those people still bring people out, they get a big room. They still have a following, people that they know personally who want to come see them play. They're like, "Oh, you're in a big room this week. I want to come see you." Next thing you know, the people got a new favorite DJ. You know what I'm saying? And like, that's why I'm big on. I like to hear people play. Because I feel like I learn from people. And two, you never, there's so many DJs, so much talent. You never know who you're going to run into. And all they need is just that one time. You know what I mean? And I love to see that people are getting that opportunity, when the time comes for them, because you just, these are people that maybe would never have played a lobby before or played at the bar code before, these larger rooms, you know? To make it long story short, I think it's just important to establish yourself, have a base for people to go off of, but put your effort in other places as well. Be a personable person, put your mixes out. Go on the night off, go check another DJ out, go network a little bit. It's not all just social media, but I think social media is very important.
You said a lot of really smart things there. But yeah, I agree with a lot of what you said as far as like social media being your resume, right? It's got to be on point. Someone who might want to book you goes there, they have to know what you do, where you play, the type of music you put out, how to book you, right? How to listen to your music. Yep. That stuff's really important. Now, like the people who rely solely on social media, they get booked. You have to back up that you can actually play. Like,
exactly.
If your social media might be amazing, but if you're whack, then you're not going to get booked again. So like Gary and I talk about how there are so many aspects of being a good DJ now. It's hard because your social media has to be point. Your skills have to be on point, right? You have to be able to also bring people out. So if you're doing a little of all those things and you're not focusing on one of them, you should be all right. Go ahead, Mark. You're calling time out. Right?
What are you doing? Look at Mark. Mark.
let me make this clear as a promoter and someone that runs parties and books DJs. For any DJs that are listening to this, it is not your job to bring people or tables. It is not your job to bring people.
Yeah, but I think that tables. Mindset, you're in the minority of people who are in your role who think that way.
But you got to back that up though. He's going to say, you got to say that, but you got to back it up because there's people who book and they'll say that. They'll say they have that mindset and then they'll be like, you know, you only brought me one table.
Right. Like, if that matters, then don't ask me how many tables I'm going to bring.
Now, like that goes back to what I was saying before. Like I said, I like to go places that are solely on atmosphere. People are going to come to your spot if you show them a good time regardless. So it don't matter who you put up there. So I'm saying places now are so bottle driven and all it's biting them in the ass because, like, listen, you have no atmosphere. So without these big DJs, you're not putting anybody through the door. That's your problem. That's your place's problem. Your place should be your servers. If they want to make money, they should be promoting. I don't see servers promoting. I don't see bartenders promoting. I don't see the door girl promoting. I don't see unless it's Camilo, I don't see the owner promoting. Like, to me, I think that's super corny. I think you should promote every single person that comes to the door because at the end of the day, your pockets. I'm getting paid regardless. Whether you book me again or not, that night you're gonna get my check. You bartender, you're not getting any tips if no one comes. So don't be mad at me because I didn't bring anybody. No, you need to promote too. This is your job. You have to market yourself just like I market myself. So to me, that's why I'm so big on, like, yes, I do want to bring people out, but that's not my job. Like, just like Mark said, like, my job is to go up there. I already have to entertain your people for 5 hours straight. So you need to do your job. You guys need to put people through the door. That's how I look at it.
I tell people this all the time. It me as a promoter, as the person running the party, my partners, you know, I do see in certain spots the staff will literally just take the flyer and just put it up and they tag the owner. Oh, look, I did my job. That's not promoting. That's just putting up a flyer and people are, you know, just, do you know what I mean? At that point, and then they turn around and they look at the promoters and the promoters are assholes because no one's there. Well, guess what? Me and my two partners can't get 900 people out at night.
Right. It's gotta be a team effort.
Thank you.
Yeah. I think the biggest thing, the thing that you brought up about hospitality earlier, it's like, it's a dying breed, right? We're in the hospitality industry. How is hospitality not the most important thing? Like, if you want people to come back, you have to have good hospitality. Like, it's crazy.
I think it's pretty simple.
I don't fuck with the bottle service clubs where it's like, how many tables? Like, I don't fuck with that shit. I never did. And I never will because I don't want to work in places like that Because I don't need to.
I mean, Cream, look at, you know, even what, 3 weeks ago, we went to Philly, all three of us, right? And I said, as soon as we got the car, what did I say to you? I said, I love coming out here because the hospitality is always on point.
Yeah, it was super on point.
And I think it's just like everyone just looks at it. It's like in our market, in our area, like if you're not on the radio, they really don't give a fuck to make sure that you're okay. You know, drink wise, even food wise. We walked into Roar and right off the bat, music wasn't even on yet. They were like, yeah, you guys want a bottle? And we're like, no, we need to eat.
Yeah, but look, food, at the end of the night, bottles, you know, everything.
At the end of the night, the owner came up to us and he was like, look, he's like, you guys were amazing. He goes, here, I got you, whatever your tab was. He looked at it, he ripped it right up. I mean, they were company, we just had to pay for the food, but still, you know, that stuff goes a long way.
Right, because you guys are now going to go out of your way to do, if they ask you to come back and maybe you're booked already or, you know, whatever it might be, like you're going to try to make that happen no matter what, because we had such a great experience as the entertainers that of course we want to go back and work there because they like did it the right way. And it was a fun party. It was a Sunday party. Like it was a good time. Like, and not enough people,
spend money and
yeah, not
people.
Enough people think that way.
I think
anyway, you say that, Cream. Go ahead.
Real quick, Wavveyy said something interesting before, probably like 15 minutes ago, about during quarantine that like he wanted to keep his followers entertained. And then, you know, it was more on Mark's job to kind of keep the ownership and management of the places that you guys were booking to keep them kind of at bay. I feel like that's still true now that we're back in the club, right? Like, Wavveyy, like, and Cream, like, our job is to keep the people in the club entertained. And then, like, it's more, you know, Mark's job and the booker's job and the promoter's job to make sure that everything else with the party is kind of kept in check.
1,000%.
You know what I mean? So I think it translates.
No, I agree with that. And I think that's basically in the definition of a DJ versus a promoter or a manager. No one's supposed to like managers or promoters. Per se, the DJ is the face, the promoter and the manager is the bad guy. You know what I'm saying? You're dealing firsthand with the people. Like the people are supposed to like me, so they come out. That makes your job easier. You know what I'm saying? And you have to deal with the BS in the background. So of course, people are not going to like you because you have to deal with the BS all the time as a promoter or a manager. You have to deal with the bad people, the drunk people, and going forward. So. Like I said, it's that amazing balance that we do have, but it's the true story of each job. You know what I'm saying? I'm supposed to put on that smile and entertain the people. I gotta act like I like everybody, and I gotta be nice to the drunk girl because it's her 21st birthday. You know what I'm saying? So like that's the true story behind it.
It's hospitality in a nutshell. We all have to have a smile on. We all have to treat everybody right because you know what? We want people back in the door. It's something that is falling short recently because we are seeing a lot of jobs fall out of place because of X, Y, and Z, not going to get into it. And, you know, it takes a little more for everybody to kind of step up and make sure the hospitality experience is what it used to be and is what it should be. Mm-hmm. People are still paying a premium to come into our places, right?
Yeah.
And due to that, like we all have to, you know, put our big boy pants on and really put smiles on our faces and make sure that people are happy at the end of the day. And everybody needs to do their individual job correctly.
Yep.
I think there's really a missing link between the DJ, the promoter, the manager, and ownership in a lot of cases. And in all of the cases that I've dealt with where all of that stuff comes full circle and everybody's on the same page, it's a very successful venue. And they're always very successful parties for a long time.
And Mary and Cream, I have a question for you too.
Go ahead.
When you, I'm sorry, not to cut you off.
Nah, you're good. Go ahead.
How many places have you played where no one came up to you and spoke to you, or you don't know, you don't even know who runs the place?
Oh God, endless amounts. Endless amounts.
And,
or you just have no idea who the manager is. And like, you might talk to two or three people, but you're like, I don't know who this person is. It could be a busboy. It could be the GM. Like I have no clue.
Yeah. You're just winging it right at that point.
Yeah.
But at a younger,
me,
at a younger age, like I didn't know that it was like really my job to go out of the way to make sure that the person knew who I was, yeah. right? Because I was yeah. always like, oh, like the shy kid in class. Like, all right, I'm going to go in, I'm going to walk in the booth and they'll come up to me. I don't yeah. have to go up to them. Later on yeah. in life, you know, as Cream and I discussed this a little more, you know, we make sure to tell our guys, like, you go up to the manager. Actually, I spoke to one of my younger DJs 3 weeks ago and I said, who was managing? He goes, I don't know. After the gig, I was so furious. It was ridiculous. Because like it's a point of pride for our guys to walk in a place, ask who the manager is, know who's in charge. Because if something goes wrong, like a water main break, like what happened 3 weeks ago, you should probably know who to talk to. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's something that Gary and I go out of our way to make sure we supply all that information for any gig that we book. Like, hey, here's the manager. Here's the equipment. Here's, yeah. you know, the bartenders. Here's the music format. Here's the whatever, X, Y, Z. And like, as we got more in the game, if I walked into a place the first time I've ever been there, I'm going to say what's up to every person, every security guard, every bottle server, every bartender. I'm going to ask if I don't know who the GM is, like, hey, who's running the show tonight? And like, can you introduce yeah. me to that person? Or can I go talk to them? Like, that's part of your job. If you want to be successful, if you want the manager to remember who you are, you got to say what's up to him or her, right? Shit.
I'm glad yeah. I asked that question. That's yeah. No, that was a amazing answer from you both, honestly, because that's super. That's just textbook networking and just,
yeah.
Like basically, textbook sales 101. Asked, you should know everyone who's from the GM down to whoever cleaned the table off.
Yeah, man. And like when you introduce yourself to all those people, you have a little leeway on your DJ set, right? Like,
yes,
you have a little more leeway as far as like, oh, this person was super cool and said what's up to me. So maybe if you aren't playing as much X, Y, Z genre that you need to be playing, they're not going to bust your balls or be like, change the music right now kind of thing. You'd be like, hey man, I need you to do this in a nice way.
Yeah.
I also think that there is a lack of understanding that like when you shit on somebody that you're working with, so like you say, oh, that bartender sucks, that server sucks, that guy's not cleaning up the tables quick enough. Like it puts a bad light on the venue that you're working at and then puts a bad light on the party that you're working at. Like, and I've worked in plenty of places that are like, oh wow, like, you know, the management in this place is not good. Like, that's just not like a good look. Like, if you are making sure that you know everybody and you have respect for everybody and you're kind of working a little harder to make sure that next guy doesn't fall behind. You mm-hmm. understand what I'm saying? Like, I want to make sure that I'm doing a good job, because if I'm doing a good job, then there's people at the bar. And if people are at the bar, that means the bartender's getting tipped. And if the bartender's tipped, it's keeping this place packed and the bouncers are staying employed, so on and so forth. Yep. And it goes all the way down the line. Like, if you have
disconnect, even to valet,
everywhere, every single person in that venue is reliant upon each other, right? So if you fail, then you're failing that next guy in line. It's like a team sport, right?
And the venue relies upon all those people as well to do a good job and then also represent the venue.
Right. But I feel like this is overlooked. Like the whole hospitality game isn't looked at as a team sport. It's looked at as this individual thing. And
a lot of corners being cut.
Right. Right. It's crazy. But
a lot of corners being cut. It's like it's like this, you know what I'm saying? I think you made a good point. I don't think a lot of people understand how important everyone is in the success of a venue.
The unfortunate part of it is that, you know, a lot of people are in this industry for the quick dollar, right? Like, so like serving and bartending and DJing, like you can make $50, $75, $200 an hour. You know, and some people dip in and out quick. So they're in it for themselves. Yeah. So it makes it a little more difficult to get people on board, but it takes good management. It takes good, promoters and people that are throwing these parties and running these establishments to get everybody on board and on the same page. Yeah. All right.
It's a big, it's a dying breed, bro. It's the last of a dying breed. Like you said, it's a lot of stuff that goes into it. So I think the problem now just with society as a whole is that it's a sense of like entitlement from a lot of people now that it's just crazy, like how it just falls down the cracks to everything, especially nightlife.
But like what we were saying, like it takes good leadership to bring everything in and get everybody going in the right direction. So
1000%.
All right. So we're coming up on an hour. I want to do some quick hitters for both you guys.
Let's do it.
So, all right. As the first one I'm going to ask is what advice would you give a DJ that's looking to either break into the industry or take the next step in their DJ career right now?
Do your homework. Work as hard as you can because there's always someone working harder than you. Network. Keep everything super duper clean, professional. And another thing that has helped me a lot is just, have your pride, but for the most part, shut up, do your job, stay out of the way of the drama, and just you're there to play the music, play the best, take it. Going hand in hand with that is make sure you should treat every gig like it's an audition. Play every gig like it's an audition because you have no idea who's going to be there.
Mark, same question.
Same things that Ed said, but also I'm going to piggyback him and say, if you're upcoming and you're trying to break into the scene, use your off time when you're not booked to go out and network with people and find out who's running the parties and see how they run their parties. If you even like it as a customer, and if you would be willing to want a DJ there, not just try to take every gig. Most of the time people are super busy and super stressful when they're working. So pick and choose your battles on when and how and where you want to come up and talk to them. And I mean, just it's always about networking yourself and building up a brand. And, I have people come up to me all the time. They're like, oh my God, like it used to be, oh my God, you're partying with Mark G, like this huge world famous, New Jersey promoter. Now it's, oh my God, you're that guy that's always with SoWavveyy.
Yeah, but that's part of your growth, man. That's your arc, yeah, your character arc.
Means you did a good job. Yeah.
I mean, just be you at the end of the day. Like I said, there's certain things that I don't want to touch and get into, but just always stand up and stand for what you believe in. And the long run, karma will play everything out.
I like it. I'm gonna jump in on this one too, because you said something and it made me think of something that I just want to say on the podcast. We always talk about coming out and going to say what's up and checking out the places you want to play and introducing yourself to the people that can book you. Don't go up to someone at 11 o'clock at night on a Friday or Saturday when it's fucking madness and it's peak hour and everyone's trying to do their job and introduce yourself. Go at when the place opens or stay over till the end of the party. Like, please don't come up to me at 11 o'clock on Thursday at Tally Ho when there's 300 people there and I'm trying to do my job and you're asking me about bookings in Hoboken. It drives me fucking crazy.
No, that's not it.
Nothing's more annoying than when I'm running around like a chicken out of head. I got managers texting me. I got DJs either running late or, yo, where's my quote unquote free bottle or this or that. And I got some guy that stops me. He's like, hey, man. I'm blah, blah, blah. I want to learn how to become a promoter or I want to learn how to, I want to start DJing.
How do I be Mark T? Like,
I'm like, dude, it's 11:30 at night on a Friday night and I'm walking tables in. Now I got to stop the table to tell you now's not the time.
Yeah.
And let me say this too. There's, we said it offline before there's always a right time and a wrong time. And there's also a way about DMing somebody because that's a lot of people use that as a tool now. There's ways that you can and can't. I would say, hey, man, if you want from me, someone that's booking, hey, when's When's your next party? I want to come check you out. Maybe, you know, we could, you know, sit down and talk over a drink. And not at 10 times. I mean, ask guys, I'll go early and sit down and talk with you and give you pointers on what to do and how to do it. And just to get yourself on, you know, give you ideas on how to get onto someone's radar without you having to go out to them every time.
Yeah. Proper etiquette is definitely lacked in these streets. 1000%.
Yeah. The people that don't like the DMs that I receive that are just like off the wall, I'm not even going to respond to, because if that's how you think that I'm going to want to talk to you, then you're not someone that I want to work with. Like, straight up.
Exactly.
The
current people understand that.
The two word DMs. Right now,
yeah.
Two word. Book me. How do you book? How can I get booked?
Let's work. Book me. Yeah. All that good stuff.
Currently right now, let's not get too off subject, but I have 16 in my DMs. So yeah, I mean, I should probably read some of them.
Yeah, I gotta go through mine too.
Oh, and I got a quick question for you guys. How do your girlfriends and Gary, you're married, right?
No.
Gary, you're not married?
No, I'm not married.
So how do your girlfriends you guys out in the clubs on the weekends? Because anytime I've ever gotten serious in the last 5 years with a girl, it's always, oh my God, you have so many girls around you, this is not blah, blah. Or you have so many girls in your DMs, when in reality, I'm like, here, take my phone. It's nothing but DJs.
Cream, you want to go first on this?
I mean, listen, we could do a whole episode on this, to be honest.
Let's make sure I'm on it.
probably should.
Yeah, I mean, my girlfriend definitely asked me questions about girls that come and talk to me or girls that follow me or DM me or whatever. But like at the end of the day, I'll do the same thing. Like, look, it's about work, you know. It's not I have no interest in like going to hook up with girls. I'm dating you. So like here, you could go through my phone if you want, but like there's nothing in there.
I'm sure in the beginning it was rocky, right? But now obviously you guys have been together for a while. So it was, it was a trust thing at first, but you build off that, right?
There was also an adjustment on my end from being a single DJ who's talking to everybody, saying what's up to everybody, knows a million girls, like to now having a girlfriend and understanding that like sometimes you have to like be careful of how you do things. You still say what's up. You could go talk to these people, introduce yourself, whatever. But like
you're just doing it different.
You have to do it differently. And you have to be a little more respectful of your significant other's feelings because listen, like I don't care how confident you are in anything. Like if you had a girlfriend and there was a million dudes coming up saying what up to them, you're gonna be like, why are all these dudes saying hi to my girl? Like,
yep.
Yeah. And I mean
it's the industry sure though, too. So it's like it goes both ways. Like this is part of our job, right?
I've been on both sides of this. I've been DJing in nightclubs and bars for 20 years this year. And wow. So I've had a bunch of girlfriends since in that 20 year time span. It's gotten to the point where with my latest girlfriend that I was like at Jump Street, I was like, listen, I'm a DJ. I'm going to have a lot of girls around me. There's going to be a lot of things via social media. Cause obviously now, like that was what, 5.5 years ago now. I was like, there's going to be a lot of things on social media, et cetera, et cetera. And if you're not comfortable with that, this is not going to work out. And I think it's very important to be straight up right off the bat, because if you're not, then like, you know, a year in, you're going to be dealing with a lot of BS that you don't really want to deal with. Like, you know, a lot of insecurity stuff. It takes a strong person to be secure with dating somebody who's in this industry. I've dated bartenders, I've dated bottle girls, and it's not easy. You know, you're coming home at 6 a.m. You're being paid to flirt with people essentially. And it is what it is. And if you're not a secure person, then you know, this isn't for you. And I think it's very, very important to let your significant other or your potential significant other that is the case. That's all I got.
Yeah, I think just being transparent and communication is just super key when you know, when you're dealing with things of that nature. You know what I mean? Like you said, it's tough, but
I think you got to make time to spend with that person too. That's really important, because I'm guilty of, you know, work. And sometimes you gotta be like, all right, I gotta put this on TO and like spend time with my girl, because I haven't done that in a little bit, you know? And I think that's important too.
Yeah. I tell Kareem all the time, real like, quick, you take the day off.
Yeah.
real quick, shout out to Anicia. Just say I'm stabbed. Thank you.
What'd you say?
Mark smart. You beat a kiss ass right now. She gonna beat his ass.
Gary, the first time I met her, Atlantic City, I think I was one of the first like people that Kareem brought her, was Atlantic City, whatever. But I ran into her when she was working at one of the bars in Hoboken, and she comes over to me waving. She's like, "Oh, guys, hey, how you doing? It's that blah blah." And I'm like, "Is that?" And he was like, "That's Kareem's girl, you don't remember?" And I'm like, "What's her name?" And he's like, "Oh, I don't know." So I completely ignored her for like a half hour, and she texted Kareem. She's like, "I'm pretty sure Mark forgot my name. You forgot my name, didn't you?" I was like, yep. She was like, "Next time you forget it," she was like, "I'm gonna murder you." And I was like, "All right, now I'm never forgetting it."
That's a typical Kareem and Gary Debbie thing. So we're at a venue for a year. What's the bartender's name?
Yeah.
We might say hi to them every week. No. Don't know their names. There's too many people involved.
Nope.
Man. All right, guys. I think we're gonna wrap here. We're pushing time. But promo stuff. So Wavveyy, you're back at Firefly Festival. Tell us a little bit about that and when it is and your experience playing those previously.
Yes. So this is going to be, it's either going to be my third or fourth year. I'm getting old, so I can't remember. But this is going to be either the third or fourth year at Firefly. I'm going back finally. Festival's going on as of now. Last year it was definitely canceled. So the way I got in through that is I work with this headphone company. So we do something called the Thicket every year. And, you know, we play, it's like, basically it's the big act and then it's the Thicket. Like that's where everyone else goes. Like everyone goes to see us play. So all day long, we rotate shifts. Like you have like maybe like three shifts throughout the day. We play all day. So leave out September 19th. When I say I leave out, I think the festival is the 21st or 23rd. But it's super dope experience to play in front of that many people, meet people from all over. And it's just people who just love music want to have a good time. So it's just, it's an experience. Just being with that many DJs, just sharing that space with them, just basically living with them for that time and you know, hearing different genres of music, how other people play from different states. And basically just being looked at as like, I'm being looked at as like a James Hype or David Guetta, whatever the fact, like, cause I'm on that.
Yeah. Stage, you feel like an artist.
Yeah.
Artist
you feel like, feel like a movie star, you know what I'm saying? Like I'm getting, you know, you get driven through the crowd and the golf nice. Cart. I'm like, you know, so it's a cool experience to just kind of put on like an act for a second, act like I'm the next Migos or something. It's pretty cool.
I love that. It's dope. Anything else? What else you guys got going on? Where are you at this weekend? Because this is gonna come out soon. So where are you guys working this weekend? Where can people come check you out?
So tomorrow it'll probably be it probably won't be out tomorrow, but tomorrow we're actually starting a new party with DJ Focus, my business partner. It's a hookah lounge / you know, like club. We're doing a ladies' night on Wednesdays. It's going to be a $60 open bar for ladies for 2.5 hours. So I think that'll be a good draw. And it's not just like house liquor. It's top shelf. Friday, I'm at the Garden. Ezra is at Perlay, which is in New Brunswick, right on Rutgers campus. No, I'm not at the Garden. I'm at Lobby. What am I talking about? Saturday.
Lord.
Saturday.
Hey, yo.
Saturday. Ez is playing at Mad Hatter. And then in Hoboken. And Sunday is... Where are we Sunday, Ez? I don't think we have anything on Sunday.
I think we might be off.
I'll have to come pop in on you on Saturday. Definitely. I'll be in town. I got to go out to Ironwood. I'll pop in.
Go.
All right, guys. I appreciate you. This was a great episode. I think we shed a lot of light on some different things that we haven't talked about in the past, which is pretty cool. Proud of you guys. and keep working.
Likewise. I appreciate
thank
you,
you sir.
Us.
Likewise. Real quick, I just want to say thank you to you guys, you two, Cream and Gary. You guys are what you guys are doing with the whole Get Down. True to you and the whole team itself. You guys make it so much easier for me to work with DJs because you guys teach them how to be respectful and how to be personable people, and how to go about talking to people like me. And you know, me and Cream talk all the time. Where I'll call them like, "Yo, what is this guy doing? Or what is that guy doing?" Blah blah blah. And Cream like, "You know what? Let me talk to him." It's just it makes my life a thousand times easier when I can call one of your guys. I need to do this and that, blah blah. And they're like, "Yeah, sure, no problem." 9 out of 10 times, they're always on time. They don't. I don't have to ever have to worry about music with them. And I mean, for some reason, most of them listen to me, so it's good.
It's very original what you guys do. It's hard. That's hard to come by. You know what I'm saying? Very, appreciate very original.
It. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, we appreciate it, guys. We work hard at what we do, and we don't expect anybody to recognize it. But when you guys do, it's definitely appreciated.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, if in the next Get Down GDU course, can I just make one recommendation that Gary teaches a early hip hop class? Because I'm tired of having these conversations with the young guys that they've never even heard the Blueprint 1, 2, or 3, or they don't know anyone in Dipset, or they don't know what the Lox is. Like it literally blows my fucking mind.
We didn't even get to dive into any music stuff today, which is what we always talk about. Yeah, so maybe part two, we'll do a music heavy one, but I think like today was really helpful for everybody. I think
I thought about this actually earlier today. It's strange that you say this, Mark. The next Get Down meetup, I'm playing an hour, and it's going to be some of the most classic back wall hip hop stuff from 96 to 2002.
I like
so
it.
So Mark can be hammered. Thanks.
as you're driving to that.
Yo. Mark can be drunk. Okay. That's all I heard.
I'm excited to hear that because that's what we used to just like chill in the room on playing music. And like, that's what we would play.
Yeah.
So, all right, guys, we're going to put all the all your socials and stuff in the show notes. SoWavveyy, Mark G, thank you guys for coming on this episode, episode 57 of the Get Down. We appreciate you.
You guys, thank you guys for having us.
Thank you.
All right, guys.
Talk to you guys soon.
Peace.